Yeah.
Okay. All right. This is going to be really hands-on for a second. Can you help me? Come here a second. Find a plug for this over here somewhere. Pick that up. Pick it up. What's your name?
Jeff.
Okay, Jeff has a vacuum pump in front of him. So this vacuum pump, you put it on parts of your body,
and it makes them bigger. We have a power cable for that, by any chance? Right here, I got it right here. Okay, so this is some of the equipment we're going to be showing off. And Jeff, I want you to touch, there, you hear that beep, that ominous beep? Okay, put your finger right here. Well, maybe you want him to hold this, actually. So, yeah, here, hold this on your finger. And then this is on right here. And then hold that on the end of your finger. Now, what do you feel?
God.
Suction. Yeah, suction. Okay, cool. You're not on any medication, are you? Okay, cool. Okay, so that's a vacuum pump. And what we've done in this thing right here, come here a second again, Jeff. We've vacuumed a chamber of strawberries here with a possibly, anyway, a very awesome substance. Which we'll talk about more in a second. So I want you to turn this screwdriver when I tell you. Okay, ready? I'm going to put my wife back here. Yeah, put it down. Just put it on the ground. Okay, go ahead. Now when I tell you, go ahead. Now what's it? Go ahead. Feels real good, doesn't it? Okay. So that's the vacuum coming out of this chamber. And this chamber, this is a thing called Revio, which is what beef jerky people use to put meat in it, right? And then when we pull all the air out of it, it sucks apart the muscle tissues, and all the marinade comes in the inside. So normally you marinate something, you have like a big fat turkey, right? You put it in a bucket for 24 hours of wine, and then maybe it comes about half an inch into the skin. But a vacuum chamber pulls apart the muscle tissue and allows stuff to go in to the very inside. Okay, you have to open this, but don't let the... Oh, I got it, it's chill. Okay. So we just have one last thing of prep to do before we can make these desserts, which is, this is a interestingly macerated bunch of strawberries that I'm going to brulee really quickly, and then we can start on the talk. This is the turbinado sugar. Do you want to come brulee? Yeah, come here a second. What's your name? Andrea. Come up here. Okay. So basically, food hacking is sort of like molecular gastronomy. Has anyone heard of molecular gastronomy? All right, that's basically fancy science shit. What it is like, some restaurants are basically stealing their... Okay, basically the cooking scene is a lot like the wares scene. There's the zero day, right? The zero day is all the techniques. And so they use techniques like vacuum chambers and stuff like that. Maybe not every restaurant has it right now. But but just like in the wares scene, there's those people who've been around for 10 years, and every time you get a new exploit, they're like, I had that 2 years ago, whatever. Like that kind of thing. Well, except the people who've had food exploits, they've had it for 50 years, and they're people who work in, like, factories, they're people like chemists and stuff like that. So people who use vacuums, I mean, that's just what people have been using, to process food in factories for the past 50 years. And so a lot of restaurants now are using those kinds of, like, science techniques, which are normally used in, have you relayed before? Okay, basically the sugar is going to caramelize, and when it turns brown, it's going to go from, like, a really simple sugar substance into a nice brown... roasty flavor. And then, so here, hold this.
Okay.
And then, turn that. Open it. The lefty Lucy. All the way up. Okay, nice. And then, go ahead and brulee all this shit. So, go ahead, pick it up. So you're going to caramelize them. Now, hold on to them for a second. Okay, now I want you to, when you're done with this, I want you to pass them over to Jules right there, and he'll plate them for us. And then, do you think there's more than 100 people in this room? Less? Yeah. All right, we have 100 dishes, so everyone share. 100 spoons. And we're totally wearing gloves, you just can't see them. Okay. All right, so go ahead. So I'll see you real quick. I just want to real quick. See that? See that's all caramelized and nasty? See that? It's like all bubbly brown. Uh-huh. That's what you want. That's what you want. So, like, give it a couple seconds on Ellen. Thank you very much. Oh, shit. Okay, this is a food hacking salon. All right, so salons, things in Paris and stuff like that. There's a lot of salons these days. Does everyone here go to Dorkbot? They don't know what Dorkbot is? Dorkbot's like a hacker show and tell. Everyone comes up and shows the cool shit they're doing with electricity.
I like salons. I like, I don't know, there's a lot of salons in my life. We have, like, book clubs. I live in San Francisco right now. We have, like, a book club on Tuesday. There's, like, a rock club on Wednesday where everyone comes over and rocks. There's, like, a writing club on Sunday. And there's a supper club on Thursday. So everyone comes over and cooks food. So basically, this is just, like, a little introduction saying, please have more salons and Skillshares. I mean, this is great. This is kind of a really bad interface, I think, for a conference. Oh, yeah. Nice. That's fine. Yeah, yeah, it's fine. Just, there you go. It's fine. Just light it back up. Yeah, that's fine. It's just, why don't you put this on? Yeah, it's probably not that flammable. Just don't, open it. Yeah, it's just, keep it a little bit further away. Okay. A little bit further away. Don't let it quench out the flame. Yeah, it's fine, dude. It's fine. Don't even trip about it. There you go. Okay, I think what you want to do, no, it's alcohol, don't worry about it.
No,
oh yeah, you want to go up, is what you're saying?
No.
You're saying, let's turn it down just a little bit. Sorry about that. this is my first time cooking, actually. This is a weird thing. I watched some TV show. That's crazy how it does that, huh? Can anyone describe the science of why that's happening? Good call. So what is this? Yeah, this is fine. Yeah, yeah. Here, go ahead and close it. All right. I need another volunteer. This one didn't work so good. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. But keep trying to relay them if you can. But if you want, we can put them onto a different thing that isn't soaked in alcohol. Like you can put them in this guy. See again? Yeah. Just turn it all the way to the right. There we go. Yeah, it stops. Okay. All right. I need you're a volunteer. Yeah. No, it's fine. Sorry. Put a couple in here and relay them a couple at a time. But actually, that's plastic, so that's not a good
idea. Yeah, that's not a good idea.
Yeah, just relay
just
a couple.
Work. Put I'll
them.
Work on this.
Yeah, okay, yeah, hook okay. it up. And then start passing them out. Okay, what's your name?
I'm Ed.
You're Ed.
Yes.
I need one more person. Yeah, you come on. So these are our fancy cookbooks. We're going to pass these around. This is food porn. Does anyone like food porn? Yeah. So one of my friends in the back is there standing guard, hopefully, somewhere. There he is, his hands up. He definitely is not armed, but. He's a really anyway, so he's here to make sure that you don't walk away with these things because they're really super cool. So you just go ahead and pass out a bunch of these books to people. So we have some really awesome chocolatier books. These are I don't know if you guys go to cookbook stores at all in America, but they're really really shitty. So these are the expensive Spanish and French cookbooks. Some of them are in Spanish and French, and so we'll just pass them around through the front and circulate them. Don't get them messy. Please return them to me. We have a checkout list. So yeah, that's great. And then, is that it? I think that's it. Okay, cool. No, that's...
Those are special.
Yeah, we don't want to give off these guys. Yeah. Yeah, and then one more? All right. Can you pass this out for me? Just give it. No, just take it and look at it. Anyway, take some time to look at those books. They're pretty cool. So molecular gastronomy is basically using science to fuck up your food, right? It's using science to make your food taste good, maybe not even noticeably. But you do all sorts of weird science. So some of the cookbooks we passed out are molecular gastronomy cookbooks. All right? Yo, guys, keep it down a second. I mean, not that my voice is that loud, but... molecular gastronomy is invented in 1969 by a British physicist known as Nicholas Curtie. He invented an inside-out baked Alaska that was hot in the middle and cold on the outside, which is the opposite of what it's supposed to be. Crazy, right? So he died, and other restaurants started, like El Bulli, which is a Spanish restaurant, opened in the early 80s, basically come out of the Spanish gastronomical societies, where a lot of chefs would... we're passing out desserts yet, right? Pretty much? Okay, cool. Where a lot of chefs in Spain, everyone gets together and cooks every day, right? Everyone gets together with their friends and cooks. And so this one restaurant, El Bulli, it's been around for about 25 years, and they do awesome stuff. They've been closed, they're closed 6 months out of the year just to have their lab, just to sit there and develop crazy food. And the other 6 months out of the year, it's really impossible to get a reservation. So then it kind of went to England, and this idea of the gastropub phenomenon. This restaurant called The Fat Duck, this is a restaurant I worked at for a little bit in the lab doing weird shit. And stuff like bacon and egg ice cream is on the Fat Duck's menu. Stuff like leather-flavored chocolate, snail porridge, mustard ice cream, all kinds of really, really creepy stuff. And the intention is to gross people out, but in a really, like, endearing way. Like, you don't want to eat snail porridge, so it's like a challenge, right? I have a funny story about challenging and nasty names. Does anyone here know the death vegetable from CDC? Anyone know that guy? So the death veggie came to my house in April, and he dropped a couple of large squids on my bed because he wanted to have a supper club and at our house. And so he went to the farmer's market, bought a couple giant squids, and just dropped them on my bed while I was sleeping. It got gooey, like squid goo all over my bed. And so I got him back, and I made choco squid, which sounds really nasty, right? But it actually was pretty good. Well, I thought it was really good. So it's chocolate-flavored squid. Yeah, it was good, right, Tom? Yeah, no comment. So anyway, then molecular gastronomy has come into America only in the past 6 or 7 years. Restaurants like the French Laundry, Alinea, Moto. Moto's kind of a famous restaurant in Chicago where they have edible inkjet paper, right? They have, so they print on, like, corn-flavored paper, and it's all edible inks and stuff like that. So they'll do something like, you know, print with milk-flavored ink on a cornflake corn paper, and it's fake cereal and stuff like that. Really crazy stuff. So why are we at a hacking conference talking about food? Well, because hacking's boring to some extent, so you hear other people talk. Because there's no delicious demos in every hacking stuff. So I'm going to talk about some of the parallels between hacking and food. So hacking is a big thing. A large part of hacking is geeking out, figuring out everything this, you know, this modem does, everything this this architecture does. Same thing with cooking. If you apply that aesthetic to cooking, you can geek out on things like organic chemistry and flavor compounds. You can know that when you eat something and, you know, it's too salty, you can add an acid and it changes that effect in your mouth. You can also learning organic chemistry really helps you become a better chef. Learning organic chemistry teaches you about why things roast and taste brown. When something tastes, whenever you roast something, like kind of what we're trying to do with the strawberries over there, you're basically creating all these extra flavors that that started with a really simple sugar. But once it started burning, an amino acid and sugar got together and had a party and made all these crazy things like furanol and furanial. So there's also the idea of like organic chemistry insofar as something like chocolate or coffee. Those are two of probably the most complex foods we eat because there's so much. There's a couple chocolate books going around on savory chocolate and just another book about how chocolate's made. And there's a lot of weird science in chocolate and all these different things you can do to it. And different, there's a couple chocolate companies that only, you know, give you chocolate from a certain plantation, like in Tahiti or in Venezuela, places like that. Actually not Tahiti, that's vanilla. But so you can buy a chocolate that just has this flavor. Maybe it tastes more camphory than this other chocolate, which tastes a little bit more sour. And so once you know about those qualities of food, you can start pairing them in different ways and creating things in a different way. So studying chemistry also allows you to figure out the use of chemistry machines, like distillators and stuff like that, things that allow you to evaporate the essence of something, like, say, garlic or parsley, and make a water that tastes exactly like that. And you can use the water to do something else with, maybe a water that tastes like fresh garlic, right? Because you can't actually boil garlic and get, because you're always going to get boiled garlic water. But how do you make a fresh garlic water? You know, you have to, you know, use fancy chemistry machines, stuff like that. I'll talk about that in a second. Another geeking out, which I think a lot of cooks do, is the idea of cuisine types. Like, people are really into Persian. I'm personally really into Persian food and Mexican food. People really get into Italian food. People really like to geek out and figure out what's authentic. What's the authentic British cuisine? Of course, it's all boiled with some onions and stuff like that in it. What's really authentic Polish food? What's really authentic Japanese food? Everyone has a big, you know, whose dick is bigger game about who's had the most wasabi and who has the most authentic, like, Japanese food experience. And so that's another thing people geek out on a lot, is the ability to, like, explore, you know, cuisines like that. And then, so the next thing I associate with hacking is collaborating to compromise platforms. If you're in a hacking group, you're hanging out with your friends and owning people, right? So if you're a cook, you're getting together in your kitchen, you're owning your diners, right? You're owning your customers, owning the people who are eating your food. And the challenge is to bring a new taste and rock their world, something maybe they've never really expected. How's the food, by the way? Yeah, I'll explain the food. Do you guys want to explain the food? Has enough people had it yet? Then we'll pass it out a little bit, and they'll tell you exactly what it is.
Tell them what they're eating.
All right, we'll tell them what it is. It's a pistachio bergamot foam that should have been in liquid nitrogen. There's a bit of a caramel, which is a rose water smoked paprika caramel tuil. There's a candied tarragon leaf. There's a saffron oil and a tonka bruleed strawberries. Now, tonka is an illegal substance that some of you are ingesting right now. But it's kind of like fake illegal. There's a lot of like fake illegal foods in the world, like marijuana and opium and things like that. So they're not, just because it's, you know, those laws were made a long time ago, so it's all good. So that's the food. It has 6 components. It's very Persian-oriented. You're not going to trip out or anything like that, but don't eat, if you're pregnant, don't put this in your body. Basically, is anyone pregnant here? No. Seriously, yeah, right on, awesome. Seriously, congratulations, but don't eat the dessert. Okay, so the other thing I think about coding, I think I like collaborative coding efforts. I like coding with my friends, and it's similar, I think, to cooking in a kitchen, except in coding, people have skills and different, you know, skill levels. It's pretty blatantly hierarchical. But in a kitchen, maybe people have different skills, but everyone comes from a different perspective. Everyone, you know, their parents cook them this different food. Maybe they grew up in Texas, they grew up in Canada. They have a different perspective on food. And so when you're in a kitchen with a bunch of people, you're collaborating and creating this cooking experience, which is everyone kind of, you know, coming together to say, you know, my mom showed me how to make cornbread, your dad showed you how to, you know, peel grapes, whatever your dad showed you how to do. And so people basically bring different palates and experience to the taste, and that's what's very collaborative about this creative experience. And it's time for a gratuitous plug. I'm on tour right now with Ali over there, and we've been driving around the country for the past 3 weeks. Well, let me start over. We live in San Francisco, and at our house there at the Unicorn Precinct, every week, every Thursday, 10 to 50 people come over. Some of these people in this room have done this as well. And everyone chips in 10 to 20 bucks for groceries, and we all just get together and cook a 6 to 7 course meal. And it's always weird stuff because we have a really weird kitchen. We have a centrifuge in the kitchen. Sometimes we have liquid nitrogen. We have all this really weird stuff, and we try and make nasty stuff, like wormwood mayonnaise, which didn't work, frankly, actually. We tried to make a wormwood potato salad. It was not good. But we all get together and try and mess with each other's aesthetics. And so Ali and I have taken it on the road. For the past 3 weeks, we've been driving from San Francisco all over the United States to cook with our friends and family. We're having a couple dinner parties here in New York, and they've been really successful. Has anyone here been to one of them at all? No? Yeah, you back there? Awesome, cool. It's really fun because people get together and maybe they aren't expecting to have to pay a lot of money. But it's really nice to have like a 7-course gourmet meal for only 20 bucks and to see your friends make it. And we usually make things people have never done before. So that's the gratuitous plug. And I wish we had t-shirts to sell so you guys could rep it or whatever. But if anyone's interested in helping us book another food hacking tour for next year or whatever, let us know. If you have an awesome kitchen and you can curate a party and get together a bunch of people, we'll definitely come over and cook a lot of awesome food with you. Okay, so now we get to the zero day part of the hacking versus food metaphor, which is the new machines, new techniques, and keeping up with new trends. So we'll talk a little bit about what some of the restaurants are doing nowadays. Basically, there's trade secrets. There's all these like chemical industries and flavor industries, and they basically kicked down their old wares to the restaurant world. How's that going, Jules? Yeah, cool. Yeah, how's the dessert? Has everyone else had some? Yeah, is it really weird? Yeah, cool, good. Yeah, it's vegan except for the tarragon, weirdly enough. So I know, strange, huh? Tarragon's not vegan. It's grown. It comes from dragon, which is where the word comes from. So we have restaurants that are competition. And this is why hacking is a little bit different, I think, than working in a restaurant. I personally don't work in a restaurant because I don't want to work 18 hours a day and 7 days a week, like trying to pump out a lot of awesome food. I'd rather sit around and dick around in my kitchen and mess around with weird stuff like rose water and, you know. This is a homemade honeysuckle syrup. Right now, we'll talk a little bit about some of the experiments we're doing later, but right now I'm really into syrup since we're making things like saffron syrup and wormwood syrup and yerba mate syrup and chrysanthemum syrup and every possible kind of syrup you would ever want to eat, and they're all pretty cool. We have a lot of weird stuff. So restaurants are in competition for who gets the new technique first. So someone comes up with a new technique, like we ate at this restaurant the other night called WD50 here in New York. Has anyone eaten there before? Yeah, it's pretty fat. It's on 50 Clinton Street. You should check it out. They have a fried mayonnaise cube, right? It's a half inch by half inch breaded cube of mayonnaise that's been fried. How do you? Yeah, they make it. They make it. It's a fresh mayonnaise. How did they do that, right? Because it has to maintain its consistency and it can't like run all over the place, right? It has to stay a cube. And so they mix in some gelling agents, which we'll talk about in a little bit. That's their zero day. They own that first, right? They announce that anyone else who does that is ripping them off, right? So that's what restaurants are all about. You go to places like El Bulli, where they had this thing called espuma. It's like a cloud where they use this nitrous canister to like foam out all kinds of weird stuff that stays in this like really intricate position. And people rip that off now. A lot of people in New York and Chicago are doing foams, but they're just all paying homage. Because there's no real intellectual property in, you can't copyright a recipe. Because you can copyright a recipe's process, but you can't copyright a list of ingredients. And if you tell me the list of ingredients, I'll know how to make it, pretty much. And so there's a lot of like recipe swapping, and of course there's the underground network, of course, of people like me and other people who go to work at restaurants for free and do the real work. Because if you're a really rich restaurant charging 200 bucks a person, you're still not making any money unless you have free slave labor doing all your work. And so young people, or old people as well. Yeah, they're awesome. it's here for old people. Any old, yeah.
They go to restaurants and work for free, and then they go to another restaurant. So they go to different restaurants every, you know, once, you know, for a month or three at a time, and then they trade all the, like, cool new techniques and stuff like that. So let's talk about some of those techniques. There's a sous vide technique. So sous vide is sort of what we're doing here. There's a really good book on it out there, but it's a, you basically use a seal-a-meal vacuum sealer to put your meat or vegetables in it or whatever, and you basically boil it. But you're keeping it at the right temperature. Now, anyone who ever had a TV dinner or that, like the bag of corn you get that you got to boil, that's basically the same thing that food industries thought of, you know, 50 years ago or whatever. But at restaurants, what you do is you take a loaf of foie gras. Is foie gras still legal here or no?
Yes.
Yeah, it is. Okay, foie gras. It's delicious, right? Any vegetarians in the audience? Yeah, but, I mean, it's wrong, right? Foie gras. Except chicken's more wrong, because chickens, they treat them even worse. But so basically, if you take a loaf of foie gras, normally you sear it in a pan, and it loses all of its mass. It loses a lot of liquid and a lot of flavor to the pan, and then you take it off and you give it to someone. But if you put it in a vacuum-sealed bag, it doesn't lose any of the liquid, it doesn't lose its shape, it doesn't lose its form. And if you hold it in a water bath, like a chemistry water bath that stays at 60 degrees Celsius for 45 minutes, it cooks it perfectly all the way through. You can hold it there for, like, you know, 4 hours, 5 hours, and it'll still be at that right temperature. And when you take it out, it tastes delicious, and it tastes really well cooked all the way through. And that's what vacuum cooking is. But, of course, it doesn't make the roast flavors, right? Because there's nothing brown on the outside of it. So what you do is when you take it out of that bath, you have to sear it with a blowtorch to make those roast flavors. Because people are counting on those roast flavors. Otherwise, it just tastes boiled. But it tastes perfectly boiled, right? But it's really well cooked all through. Some other techniques are jacquard marination, which is this really nice, it's like a 10 little blades that you just puncture into like a big steak or something. And magically, the steak tastes a crazy tender, and all the marinade gets into it. It's because it's the same thing you're doing on this vacuum chamber. You're opening up pathways to the inside of the meat. And it's pretty amazing how well you can marinate something with just this like stabby knife contraption. This is a nitrous oxide. Has anyone here enjoy nitrous? Yeah, I thought I saw a bunch of little android turds out on the street leading up to the hotel. And so nitrous oxide is an amazing thing, because what you're doing with the nitrous oxide siphon, like Jules has right there, is you are aerating the fluid that's inside it. So when you put cream in it, it's a whipped cream charger. You put cream in it, you're aerating the cream, like just like you would whip it with a whisk, except you're super aerating it with really cold nitrogen or nitrous oxide, actually. So that's what that does. And so you can put anything in that canister and foam it out. So what we've done is we've done a pistachio bergamot foam. And what that is we took this blender here, this 200 mile an hour blender that's got some water in it, and we've put a bunch of pistachios in it. I think I can unplug this. And we blended it at 200 miles an hour, and we've added some substances to it to make it, here's some pistachios. How's it going, guys? You're out of the foam? Yeah. All right. You can open it up and there's foam inside it, but just make sure it's like done all the way. Or it's like hold it upside down. So what you would do is you would take this blender top that goes 200 miles an hour. You have some water in it. Probably don't want it to be at an angle. Uh-oh. Well, I'll make some more.
Uh-huh. Someone's getting a kind of gimpy foam.
Now the heart attack.
Okay, so that's 200 miles an hour. And then we have these things called essential oils. And this is a bergamot. Does anyone know what bergamot is? Anyone heard of bergamot? You drink Earl Grey tea? That's what it is. It's this small little citrus flavor. Okay. So that's my, like, this needs a little more water. Does anyone have any water? Is that other thing of water right here? Yeah. So a little more water. We're just going to put a couple drops of this bergamot essential oil in there. And then we want this to basically be like cream in that siphon. But how's it going to be like cream? Any ideas? Any suggestions from the audience? What magical substance? Hint, it's on this table.
Oil.
Lecithin. Soy lecithin? Anyone? It's what's inside eggs. It's what's inside egg yolks. So we have six little drops of this stuff. And then a little bit of soy lecithin, which I'll mix in because it's this nasty, sticky stuff that gets on your hands. But this is from soy. Normally you get it from eggs. And I have to push this really quick. Sorry. Okay. So basically, we mix soy lecithin, and lecithin is an emulsifier. And that means it takes fat and water and mixes it together, because fat and water don't like to mix. And so when you add lecithin to something, like if you add an egg yolk into a salad dressing, you're helping it all mix together, basically. So I'm just adding fake lecithin in it, or rather non-egg lecithin in it. I have to let the water get to the bottom. That's why it's not actually moving, because it's trying to create a vortex in the bottom. See, basically, if you go into a kitchen and you know why everything's happening at a scientific level, you can basically be a lot more creative. And it's the same thing with hacking as well. There we go. So it's vortexing. I'm just gonna pour a bunch of this in. And it starts getting a lot thicker. The other magic ingredient is agave nectar, which is a vegan honey. Agave is the plant that they use to make tequila, and so it's this big tequila leaf. It's an agave plant. The blue agave takes 8 years to mature, and then they roast it in the state of Jalisco, and it's a really super sugary thing. Yeah, it's a lot. It has a lot of fructose in it, so it's a lot like honey. It's appropriate for diabetics, because it's really sweet. Okay, I think this is fine. Are you ready for some more foam? Okay. Yeah, it's all right. I need to add a little bit more lecithin, actually. So it's not the creaminess of cream right now. So I'm gonna keep adding a little bit of lecithin to it. Thanks so much for your help. Yeah. And a little bit more of my essential oil. Okay, that should be fine. And does anyone here know how to crack nitrous into a container? I do. So we're going to fill this up. Man, I'm glad I brought more pistachios. How many people have had the dessert? Yeah, what do you guys think? Yeah? Sweet. Thank you. Do you want to go ahead and load it up? Just make sure it's on real super tight. Yeah, I wish it was. Okay, so here's what would happen if we had liquid nitrogen in the foam. You ready for this? It's a foam, right? So it's a puffy thing, like it is sitting on your plate. So what you do, this is a trick from the Fat Duck, because they do the same thing, except they do it with a different kind of foam. They use a different process to make it. You take this foam bubble on the edge of a spoon, and you put it into a bowl of liquid nitrogen, which is negative 191 degrees. Ooh, this got caught. So it's negative 191 degrees. The outside of it freezes and crystallizes, but the inside of it's still a foam. And so when you take it and put it in your mouth on a spoon, it's this hard ice thing in your mouth that bursts into foam and coats your mouth. It changes phase, right? From a solid to a liquid in your mouth, which is very surprising, and it coats your mouth and gets the flavor like all over your mouth. It's pretty nice. At the Fat Duck, they do it with a vodka, a lime, green tea, mint, and it's really super nice because the green tea cleanses your palate as an astringent. The vodka coats your mouth with vodka, which is great. And why is it great? Because fat is soluble in alcohol, and fat is what carries flavors. So at the beginning of your meal, you have this, your mouth is being coated with this alcohol, and then you're ready to eat, and it's going to taste delicious, right? Because all the butter and shit they put in your food is going to be really cool. Okay, so that's nitrous. There's gelling products. Another one of the things we put in the first batch, but maybe not this batch. Is that working, Jules? Is that working? Oh, how many were left in it? I think there's... They're in the box. Okay, who has nitrous? Okay, let's just... I'll just foam it up with... So this is... Okay, this is a good example. Did you put some in? Did you put one in already? Okay, so what we're going to do is... nitrous is what is aerating the first batch of this. And so we're actually going to put a different gumming agent into it, a gelling agent called xanthan gum, which is totally natural. It's in a health food store. Although my mom's an anti-MSG freak, and she thinks xanthan gum is very evil because it's an additive, but not all additives are bad. So xanthan gum is basically, there's a bacteria called X. campestris, and it makes, or xanthan campestris, and it makes this byproduct. And the byproduct is this really long carbohydrate that when you put water around it, it starts gumming it up and making it jelly-ish. So we're going to add just a little bit of xanthan under shear. Luckily, I unplugged this. So under shear, we're just going to add a little bit of xanthan until it foams up, right? So here's the xanthan powder. This is going to go from a liquid to a nice, thick, pasty foam. And we'll put that on your plates, and you'll love it. Mmm. Let me stir it. A little bit more. Yeah, how are you guys doing so far? Is this an okay talk? You guys feeling all right, good. Thank you. Sounds unhappy, doesn't it? Okay. This is fine. Do we have this guy right here? Okay, see how this is? Look at this now. This was liquid. Look at that. Yeah. Where's the shot? Where's Mr. Photographer Jake Applebaum now? The action shot. Okay, so look at that. Jelly, right? We did the same thing, except it's not the same thing, clearly. So this is going to be a lot heavier. Can you hold this a second? Yeah, and then... Yo, can we give a hand to everyone helping us with the dessert? Yeah. Yeah. Or dessert or whatever this is. Okay, just put like a little bit of a spoonful on each of the things. Do you have a spoon? Yeah, here's one. Okay. So just like throw it down like this. Go. There you go. And then make sure you put the stuff on. Okay, so what else is on the plate? There's blueberry salt. Did you guys notice that? Yeah. Who's had the dish? So my really good friend who's sitting in the back checking the books has a dehydrator, and he put blueberries in a dehydrator, and then he made blueberry powder. And it looked like some sort of weird cyber drug that you read about in a William Shatner novel. And it was this blue powder, and we blitzed it with a bunch of sugar and sea salt. So we had that salty flavor. And the salty flavor, when you put salt on something, it's osmosis. You have a cell wall, right, when you put it on food, and put on vegetables. There's a vacuole with water in it. So we put salt on it, osmosis draws the water out of the vacuole and concentrates the flavor. And that's why you use salt in brownies and for the chocolate. You're not trying to make the brownies taste like salt. You're trying to draw out some of the water so the flavor concentrates. And so as we put a little bit of salt on this, this sweet pistachio foam that we just made it's going to appreciate the salt a little more. And salt and caramel is a really nice combination as well. I need to wipe my hands for a second. What else? Oh, there's this tweel. So the tweel is, thank you. These caramel chunks are smoked paprika and rose water. So there's a lot of floral stuff in this food that we're making. There's rose water, there's bergamot, and there's this aromatic tarragon right here. The tarragon, it's really humid. So normally this is really crispy tarragon, so it's a little mushy right now. But it's really humid. Basically, it's egg whites and dipped in sugar. And you'll notice we're just giving out the recipes for things like this. And maybe some restaurants do that, maybe some don't. But I think that's a big thing about food hacking is open sourcing your recipes, right? And either Creative Commonsing or licensing or whatever. So we have a website, foodhacking.com. You should check it out. It's got a lot of recipes on it. And I'll show you the wiki in a second, too. Okay, some other weird techniques. Those are some gelling agents. There's other ones like gelan and gelatin and alginate. So for example, at WD-50, when they do this this deep-fried mayonnaise cube, they put two different gelling agents in it. One to keep it that solid shape, and the other one to not make it run, so it's going to be really solid. It's hot. It's hot mayonnaise. Of course it's going to run, but it doesn't. It just stays in this like really thick block. There's a lot of really cool other things you can do with gelling agents. The other dish we had there was we had methylcellulose noodles, where they had this really long chemical called methylcellulose. You get this really nice bowl of miso soup, and you have a squirt bottle full of noodle. And it's a liquid squirt bottle, and you submerge it in the water, and you squeeze it all out, and it makes a noodle. The liquid sesame turns into a sesame noodle, and you pick it up on your fork and you eat it. And it's a noodle. So that's another gelling agent. It's something you add to water. A liquid to make it gel up. There's also papers and pastas. So we've already talked a little bit about the dehydrator. A big thing these days is people are talking about making like chocolate paper and passion fruit paper. And basically what you do is you mix a gelling agent with some sort of passion fruit juice or whatever, and then you kind of just squeegee it out onto a tray like the one over here, and then you put it in the dehydrator, and then you get this nice thin paper depending on which gelling agents you put in it. One of the dishes at the Fat Duck, which was my job to make every other day or whatever, was we did the Listerine strips. Right? You taste Listerine strips? Instead, instead of that flavor, we had oak and oak moss flavored. And it was part of this dish that meant you were in the forest. And the first thing you do is you put this Listerine strip in your mouth and you let it dissolve. And there's oak and oak moss. And then you eat this like truffle walnut toast that's like, okay, there's truffles. I'm on the floor of the forest and there's truffles. And then there's like an egg. And the egg has like, you know, langoustine and quail and peas and foie gras in it. And you're like, I'm eating everything in the forest. I am the floor of the forest eating its bounty. And that's a different kind of alginate. Listerine uses Pull-O-Land gum, a different kind of gumming agent. We use something totally different. But this, you know, it's like three or four different gelling agents that have different kinds of qualities that allow you to basically squeegee out this really thin layer of stuff and then let it dry for a day and then cut it, and it hooks you up. So there's meat glue. Anyone use meat glue before? All right, meat glue is awesome. So the Japanese, you guys like the Japanese? Yeah. They brought us MSG, right? Ajinomoto, MSG is basically the powdery stuff that's on seaweed. And it's this really concentrated flavor that's umami. And this is made about 100 years ago. It was isolated by this doctor who's really hooked up the food world by isolating the fifth taste, right? So we have taste buds, right? And the taste buds are telling your mind why to eat this thing. It's like if it's sweet, you're like, yo, baby, eat this. It's sugary. It's giving you energy. If it's salt, it's like, yo, you're not going to dehydrate if you eat this. It's salty. If it's sour, it's because it's acidic. It's an acid. And if it's bitter, it's because it's an alkali. And most poisons are alkaline. But if it's savory, which is this other taste, which is sort of like tomatoes or seaweed or MSG or really savory mushrooms like shiitake, it's basically telling your body, this is an amino acid. This is a ribonucleic acid that we need for our body to generate our cells. And so that's what MSG is. It's a glutamic acid. So they also invented this other thing called meat glue. And meat glue is when you use your muscles, as some hackers do, you rip your tissues all the time, microscopic little tears. And so your body makes this thing called transglutaminase, which joins back the muscles, joins them back together. And then so the Japanese, of course, synthesized this with some enzymes. And so you take a steak, a raw steak, and then you take a raw chicken breast. And you sprinkle some on the steak, and you sprinkle some on the chicken breast. And you put them together. And 2 hours later, it's the same piece of meat. It cross-links the proteins. It's transglutaminase. And then you fry it on the stove, and you've got steak breast or whatever it's called. And people eat it. Yeah, it's weird. But you can get like free samples of it. You just go to, just Google for Activa. That's its trade name or whatever. And it's pretty nasty. But they mostly use it for like firming up noodles. Oh, are we on the internet? Apparently not. Okay, so basically it's called Activa. Some other cool techniques. Freeze-dried food, you can use a freeze dryer. Liquid nitrogen, we talked about. Squeegeeing out films. Hydrosols, that's kind of interesting. There's a restaurant called Joan Roca, which we passed out his book. His book is on vacuum cuisine. By the way, no one steal the books, please. No one's going to steal the book, right? Steal the books? No? Good, thanks. This guy Joan Roca, makes a dirt jelly or a dirt hydrosol. This is what he does. You know how to distill whiskey, right? You boil things and you distill it with a distilling column. So what you do is if you want to distill something, you put it in a beaker or a flask and you boil it, and then you catch the steam with an ice column and then condense that steam, and that's how you distill something, right? So what this guy does is he puts dirt and water and boils it and condenses the steam, and he has this pure water that tastes like his dirt. And his dirt is delicious. Because it's like he's in the Basque country or whatever, Catalan or something like that, and his dirt's awesome. It's just really good dirt, and it doesn't get it. Nothing. The only thing that made it over is anything that could be boiled and evaporated and condensed. So that's some cool shit. People do that now, but you have to have like a $5,000 distillator apparatus and make it super cold. What?
Is that how jelly
belly? No, that's not how jelly belly. No. You mean to get those flavors?
Yeah.
No, you can have essential oils for anything, but this is more like for in the field. So if Jelly Belly wanted to make the dirt in Northern California where the Jelly Belly factory is, it's flavored jelly bean, they'd have to do that. But mostly you have essential oils. So we have some essential oils right here. They're pine and camphor. We do chocolates. We do like a eucalyptus chocolate and a bergamot chocolate, and it just messes up your palate. It's pretty cool. At the Fat Duck, they do leather chocolate and oak chocolate and tobacco chocolate. It's basically just a couple drops of that essential oil in with the chocolate, and it's just, that's the essential characteristic flavor of it. So edible inkjet cartridges, I already talked about. Modified breakfasts. Maybe I'll do that in a second. Okay, so freeze drying and modified breakfast. So at WD-50, again, and there's only maybe 10 restaurants in the United States that do this kind of food. And I'm not even at the part where I talk about the hacking, about the hack lab part, but that part's actually pretty small. So I'm still talking about the weird technologies right now. So they do a freeze-dried food at WD-50 where it's they freeze-dried some bananas and strawberries. And they have this dish called cereal with cold milk. And it's a cold milk ice cream surrounded by crushed, is it really 10 minutes or 15 minutes, right? 9:45, my shit says. All right, well, I'll keep going. Anyway, it's a cold ice milk ice cream surrounded by ground up homemade cornflakes. So this is basically this ball of cornflakes surrounding ice cream. with like little bits of freeze-dried fruit. It's pretty cool. Okay, so let's talk about Hack Labs in the next 10 minutes, apparently. It's basically setting up a laboratory devoted to your cuisine. So where I worked at the Fat Duck, they have a dedicated lab. The El Bulli, they close 6 months out of the year. I'm going to talk a little faster. Few restaurants can afford to have a dedicated Hack Lab, a dedicated like food where the lab where they're developing stuff. So they develop it on the job, which sometimes is good and sometimes is bad. So there's a restaurant in Chicago called Alinea. They charge $250 to eat the 25-course meal. And like I had it, and a lot of it was awesome, but most of it was not good because it's the weird stuff that he just invented that morning. And he's like trying it out on people as guinea pigs. There's also, Sagan? Yeah, there's no more plates. So that's 100 plates. But anyone wants to put their fingers in the bowl, we'll come up afterwards. We'll get everyone later. So that's basically how you develop, how you set up a Hack Lab. And if you have a restaurant, you have to be making that 3% profit margin. Some of them pair up with industrial designers and chemists. Like Pierre Gagnier's restaurant in Paris pairs up with a really weird dude named Hervé Dis to like invent all this stuff, and then they'll figure it out and serve it to people. So the ghetto tech, this is what really makes it hacking, which is restaurants are doing it for money. I'm doing it personally for the real and to collaborate with my friends and not for money or customers. And it's a non-proprietary, documented through techniques and experiences. I think I have a wiki page. Here we go. This is the food hacking wiki at wiki.foodhacking.com. So here's some equipment we talked about, some ingredients like meat glue and techniques. And so basically this is going to be a huge wiki that has a lot of weird science of food stuff on it. And so I encourage you to apply for an account and help edit it. So what is the experimentation? So let's talk a little bit about that. I have a kitchen in San Francisco. Jules and I have a kitchen, and we do a lot of weird esoteric ingredients, a lot of weird stuff, right? Like we have mastic, we have wormwood. We do wormwood a lot because it's got this psychoactive ingredient in it called thujone. And thujone sends you on spirit quests, right? It's like it causes synesthesia. So we're trying to like work that into food in some way that doesn't tip off your body that it's a bitter poison, which is what wormwood is. Some really good advice I got from a long time ago from one of the chefs I worked with is, yo, Mark, that's my real name, by the way, Guides, sorry, I forgot about that. He's like, this is what you should do. Smoke weed and read cookbooks. That's my advice. Now, he was giving me a hand job at the time, so I don't know what that was all about. That's a good, whatever that means. If whatever substance you do or don't do to open up your mind and read cookbooks, that's what you gotta do. Read other people's aesthetics and eat other people's food and open your mind to it. So we've got this documentation stuff online. You guys should check out. Are there any questions? We have 5 minutes for questions. I don't know. Can you? Yeah. Are there any questions? I feel like I should tell you guys a lot more stuff. There's a thing right there you can talk at. What? Isn't wormwood a what?
Isn't wormwood one of those controlled substances? Honestly, as far as the law is concerned.
No. Absinthe is, but wormwood isn't absinthe. And you can buy wormwood at any witch shop in like New Orleans. I mean, really. And Renfairs. No, thank you for asking. What other questions? Any other? Yeah? What's up?
No, I'm dying of curiosity. You guys are mixing all this stuff up there. I have no idea what you made. I know you don't have any plates, but what does it taste like after all that work? Does it taste good? It looked kind of goopy and weird. And
can someone make her a plate? Yeah, someone make her a plate. Next question that's not begging for food. Handout lines over here. Yeah.
Just a quick question. Are you going to be at SalonCon at the end of September?
What?
SalonCon. It's a convention of nothing but salons.
Wait, is that a question?
Yeah, will you be there?
No.
You should. People will love you.
Thanks. Next time, tell me where it is. And
afterward.
Okay, cool. Yeah, but that's just my first answer. No, I'm not. I mean, yeah.
Hey, great talk. Hot peppers. It seems like the hotter you make stuff, the less pepper flavor you can maintain. How can you make something very hot but also keep the flavor of the peppers and the essence of the pepper intact?
Yeah, sure. Okay, so when there's a trigeminal flavor. So how many tastes are there in the mouth? Right. There's the big five. So a sugar, salt, sweet, bitter, and then savory. And then there's the two other weird ones. Like there's the trigeminal ones. There's the it's burning me flavor, right? Which you turn it up and you can't feel the other stuff. And then there's the it's cooling me off flavor, which is menthol cigarettes, right? Or whatever. Anything that's menthol or camphor, it's like that cooling flavor, right? How do you want to do it? It's the perception. I personally, here, give me your, come here. Who was that? Are you? Come here. Give me a finger.
Oh, I know that. Yeah. Sure, it's sweet and hot.
Yeah, that's how they do it. So the sweetness, it makes it really hot and it lasts long, but the sweetness...
Is this
It's rooster sauce.
There's so much stuff in it.
This is not MSG in it. And MSG. Yeah, this is. It's like sun-dried chilies, basically, with like some sugar in it. It's chili, sugar, salt, garlic, distilled vinegar, potassium sorbate, sodium bisulfate, and xanthan gum. Your little friend on here to thicken it up. Yeah, you guys can check the E numbers. If you go to the Wikipedia page on E numbers, you can see all the weird additives, and they have all their E numbers, and they explain what they are, and they're all in categories like. E400 is gelling agents, and E300 is emulsifiers. What's up?
Okay, my question was, I know that there's a lot of substances out there that as they dissolve, they make sense and stuff, but they don't add any taste or anything. I know that your sense of smell is directly connected to your sense of taste. Have you thought about maybe adding some of that to your palate so that you're using your full palate, the nose and the tongue?
Thank you for asking that question. So anyone here have a baby? A kid? Okay, now you have four. Now, basically, I'm just going to speak to you for this whole thing. Basically, your little adorable pumpkins, when they were inside you, allegedly, I mean they were probably at some point, everything you ate, Indian food, fish, unless you don't want mercury in your blood, and all this other stuff went into their bloodstream as well. So all the flavor molecules that you eat when you're in your mama's little tummy, goes into your bloodstream. So if you eat Indian food, if you basically eat a really diverse diet when you're pregnant, your kids will have those flavor molecules. And so that's the first step how your palate gets developed. Your next step is when your mother breastfeeds you, assuming you're not, you're breastfed, and you everything that goes through your mom's breast milk is going into your body that way. It's the same thing, flavor molecules. The next step of acquiring a palate or a sense of taste is socialization. You see your mom and you love your mom. And what your mom's eating, you love that. You want to eat it. You want to touch it. And when you see your dad, you like him too, probably. And then you want to eat his stuff. Then the next sense is the social sense, where you see your friends eating and you really want Lunchables or Pokemon, whatever thing. Because it's really delicious. Okay, so here's the deal, though. Here's the bad news. When you're six, that is when your palate is at its best. And then it goes downhill there for the rest of your life. And that's why kids are picky about food. It's the sense of smell. You have seven tastes. A really good trick you can do, eat a half-inch cube of potato, half-inch cube of apple with your nose being held. Ooh, I just touched the sriracha odor. I was just picking you up. With your nose being held, the only difference between those two things, they have the same taste, but it's a different smell, right? So basically, there's this idea of super tasting as well. So basically, your sense of smell goes downhill, meaning your sense of taste, because flavor is your taste buds times your smell. And maybe you can smell 20,000 different things, but by the time you're 40, it goes really downhill. And by the time you're 60, it's almost gone, which is why old people put like sugar and salt in their food, because that's what they can taste. Now, that doesn't happen if you're like a wine taster. It doesn't happen if you train your palate every day. It doesn't happen if you eat lots of weird stuff, or if you live on a farm, probably, and you're smelling things all the time. And so I think what you're asking is there a way to like mess around with smells? And that's what we were doing with this cuisine, was adding an aromatic element, which was this floral element, things you're not really used to eating, which is bergamot and the rose water. And so I'm hugely fan of floral stuff, because I really like white boy Middle Eastern Persian fusion stuff. So yeah, what's up?
I was just curious, you were talking about making different kinds of syrups, and I was wondering if you've been playing with liqueurs at all, like bitters or infused liqueurs.
I don't brew stuff myself, but I flavor liqueurs with syrups. But if you are interested in a syrup zine, it's like 30 pages and I'm almost done with it. It's got like, it's Persian syrup techniques, and it's like how to make syrups out of hemp seed and almonds, and then all the weird stuff's at the back, like roasted corn syrup that's like you roast corn, and then put like corn on the cob, and you put like lemon or lime on it, and cinnamon, and chili pepper, and then you cut off the kernels and boil that in sugar water, and then you have a syrup that tastes like roasted corn. Get it? Corn syrup, roasted corn syrup. Come on. Yeah. Anyone else? Okay. I'm stopping, but can I please? It's Jason Scott.
I just wanted to say, with your talk almost gone, Weeds, thanks for bringing us somewhere really different.
Thanks. Okay. Well, thank you very much. Thank you. Thanks very much. Mess around with food. Just like go hack with food and have a really good time at the conference. And anyone wants samples, we'll be in the back. We just have to clean up all this stuff first. So thanks. Yeah.